Well, here we are, gang. Section 1.5, the last of our review, exponentials and logarithmics. We're going to be getting into a little bit of details, but just a quick overview otherwise. And again, hopefully you remember pretty much everything that we went over from this entire chapter one, which is all review. Let's get you started with a couple definitions, 1.5.1 and 2. What is an exponential and logarithmic function? Well, you can see we got y equals b to the x, where b is some number, some value. There are some restrictions on it, though. We have to have it being positive, so greater than zero. Not zero, because we then know that anything that we would get would equal zero. And for similar reasons, that's why we cannot have a one either, because we know one to any power, no matter what it varies to be, would still be a one. So there are a few things that you should already know with that, depending on what the base is, would make it either increasing or decreasing. Same with the logarithmic. We just reviewed in the last section what an inverse was, the reverse, and these two are that of each other. So if you had something like an x up in the exponent, you could take the log of both sides in order to bring this down. So those are the types of things that we're going to get into a little bit review today, because those will be things that we will have to go way back into our tool belt, pull out, and make sure that we know how to use in order to establish what that x might be if it's in the exponent. Okay. Now the logarithms is the reverse or inverse of that, where we still have some base value, some x input, and some y output. Same rules apply because, yes, these are inverses of each other. So we still need to have that base non-negative, greater than zero, and not one. Now, as far as logarithms go, I like to just use exponents in disguise as my moniker for what they actually are and how they behave, because if you remember, we just said that these are inverses of each other. So if I was to take this exponent x and flip-flop it with the y, well then that would mean over here that my y is equal to the exponent because we reversed them. So when we talk about exponents in disguise, when referring to logarithms, that's what we mean, and I'll talk more about that as we progress through. As far as how to tell whether these things are increasing or decreasing, as Megan Trainor mentioned, all about that base, okay? So whether that base is greater than zero, which is the restriction, it could be a fraction, or it could be greater than one. And so that's what we're gonna go ahead and make sure that we understand real quick before we move on. I'll show you some graphical representations of that, and we'll continue on with our quick overview and review chapter one. So an exponential logarithm function is what when the base is what? See if you can fill these two things in if you haven't already. If not, I'll give them to you in just a second here. So notice I put exponential or logarithmic for each of these because the base has that common restriction, and no matter whether it's some base to a power or down here below in the basement for our logarithms, that base will give us an increasing function when it is greater than one. Right? It has to be strictly greater because remember, we said that that was a restriction. It can't be one. Otherwise, we'd always get the same number, which means that doesn't leave much else, because we said that it also had to be greater than zero. So if it's not greater than one, then that means it's less than one. But remember, we still had that restriction that it also had to be greater than zero. So in other words, we're looking at fractions that are less than one, because remember, 3/2 is still a fraction, but it's greater than one. So make sure you understand that for increasing, greater than one, decreasing, fraction. Something less than one, but still positive. Okay, so here's what those would look like. So just a few examples there of both increasing or decreasing. And remember, we always read left to right on these. So as our x's get larger, what do our y values do? And it can do one of two things. It can either increase, as you can see, 2 to the x increases slower than the 4 to the x. Or it can decrease, 1/2 or 1/4. And again, you can see that those happen the further away from 1 they are, the quicker they either increase or decrease. Here are some of the things that we'll talk about that we haven't slightly moved or stretched or reflected anything yet. There is a common vertex that these all have. You can see that right there. That's why I'm calling it the quote-unquote vertex. That's our starting point. We will take this and then pick it up and move it down, up, left, right, whatever, and then build the thing right back based off the base and whether it's increasing or decreasing. There's also a horizontal asymptote that these all have initially. Again, it looks like it touches, but we know if we were to keep plugging things in, we would just keep taking a half, a half, a half, a half. And what happens when you take half of something? You're still left with the other half. Okay? So there's always going to be something, but you can see it's definitely approaching zero, whether it's all the way out here to positive infinity or all the way out here to negative infinity. All right? The domain of these exponentials, as I just mentioned, you can see that they go to the far left and right. And we would get values even though they'd be really, really small in either direction. Here, really big or really big. So we'd say that those go to infinity, where these would go to zero. All right, so the domain of those is all reals, or you can write it in interval notation, things like that. Range, not quite everything. You can see here that there is that borderline we call an asymptote along the x-axis. But we will hit almost everything above it. Not quite, because remember, it's not going to touch, so it wouldn't ever actually reach the zero. So the answers to these are, and remember we talked about the interval notation, and where there's a parenthesis, it's like an open dot. And where there's a bracket, it's like a closed dot. All right, so we cannot include infinities because they're ideas. They're not actual numbers that you can physically touch. So you will never, ever include an infinity. The zero is not included on this either because, as we mentioned, asymptote. So let's take a look at the logarithmic functions. Now, don't forget, logarithms are simply just the inverse. So if we took everything we just had and did the reverse, you tell me, what would you get without even looking at these and giving a quick explanation? And hopefully you came up with those answers instead of what we had up here as our quote unquote vertex, 0, 1, the inverse would be 1, 0. Again, about that line, y equals x. So again, all these things will be the inverse or reverse of what we just got with exponentials. So instead of a horizontal, we will now have a vertical asymptote. Instead of y equals 0, now it'll be where x is equal to 0 everywhere. Y could be anything. Okay, domain, everything in the x direction from 0, not including it, to infinity. And if it's increasing, whether it's a base of 10, e, or 2, it will still hit everything down here. And eventually, depending on the base, it'll hit infinity. Those are all increasing graphs. A decreasing would be something that looks like this. And again, that would have a base that is fractional, 1/2, 2/3, something less than 1. Quick overview of logarithms and exponentials and their graphs and a few of their attributes. We talked about how they are inverses. Here's another way to look at their relationship and their graph. Notice these are symmetrical about that line y equals x, and they're identical because of the base being the same. So as I mentioned earlier, I like to say that logarithms are just exponents in disguise. Let's review some rules of exponents before we get to the rules of logarithms. Let's see if you can fill out these laws of exponents before we get to the laws of logarithms. Hopefully you're able to fill those in. Pretty simple stuff, things that we learned very early on in our algebra career. When we have the same base and we are multiplying, that would mean I'd have B times itself, say four times, and then we're multiplying again by B, say three more times. Well, then that means I have it here times itself four times, here times itself three times. So that would just be a total of having it times itself seven times. So whenever we're multiplying, we add the exponents. Likewise, dividing, subtract. When we have a power to a power, we end up multiplying the powers. Again, notice all the bases are the same. When we have more than one thing to a power, we will have each of those things that many times. Likewise, when we're dividing. And the tricky one, b to the zero. Remember, anything to the zero power is one, not zero. Quick little proof for you. Let's say we had 5 cubed over 5 cubed. You all know that anything divided by itself is one. But according to this rule right here, when the bases are the same, we can subtract the exponents. So we then know that we're going to have 5, same way we read top to bottom, and subtracting. When you divide, things typically get smaller. So that means we now have 5 to the 0 power. And because this is equal to this, which is equal to this, which we said was equal to 1, then we know that these are equivalent. Pretty simple little proof. Again, it's very concrete. Just wanted to make sure that you do not make the mistake of saying the answer was 0. Now that we've reviewed the laws of exponents, let's see if we can apply what we mentioned our logarithms are, just exponents in disguise. Now again, we have some rules, some stipulations about the letters, all right? But if we have a log, which is just an exponent in disguise, and we took the two things and multiplied, when did we ever multiply with logs or exponents? Well, remember, that's when we were adding. That's when we were multiplying. So now we're just working in reverse. So we can actually take the log of the first thing, A, with that base of B, and the log of the second thing, C, with that base of B. And we know that this exponent and this exponent, when they were adding, we were multiplying, just like we talked about up here. Likewise, when dividing, we would therefore take the log, which again are just exponents in disguise. And when we're dividing exponents, we end up subtracting. And then lastly, one of our more important ones that we will use more often in this class is that power property. When we have an exponent raised to an exponent, what did we end up doing? We ended up multiplying the exponents. And again, because logs are just exponents in disguise, do you see that exponent raised to another exponent? Well, then technically we could just bring this R down and multiply. But that looks a little close to this. So what we say we do instead is we will take this R and bring it down in front so that there's no mix up with this type. So we will say that it's equivalent to R, the exponent, times our other exponent in disguise, log A base B. Now remember, every single one of these can be written as these, and therefore any of these can be written as those. So whether you're working left to right or right to left, make sure that you know these laws. And again, as I mentioned before, that one in particular. Now, just to make sure that you're all aware of the most commonly used logs, we actually call this the common log. When there's no base written down there, that means it is equivalent to a base of 10. And then the natural log, we don't write N and then L for the natural log. It's actually LN. And I highly recommend you put a cursive L because a lot of people will put IN. And if you're putting this into a computer program for your homework and you put capital IN and it comes out looking like this, that's not the same as this. At least the computer will not read it that way. Okay. So if you're just writing it out, no big deal. Don't need the cursive L, but I always try to emphasize that this is the still logarithm, which is why we're starting with L. It just happens to be the natural base of E. Okay, so no need to write either of these. Those are identical or equivalent. So that's pretty much it for this section, this whole chapter of review. I know it was quick. I didn't go into too much detail because this is everything that we already have studied, especially those that just came from college algebra, trig, or even a pre-calculus course. This is all stuff you should have seen. So just a quick reminder that although it was very quick, maybe pushed to your limit, you'll see why I said that in the next chapter. Don't worry, I'm going to be coaching you through this, helping you guys to comprehend the material as best as I can. And the better and the harder you work, paying attention to those details, being nice, neat, and organized, and finding a little bit of maybe joy, and finally figuring out why you learned all the math you did prior, it's all for calculus. Then it'll definitely help in the long run, right? So really, really work hard to comprehend why you're doing something, not just how, because that's not going to get you very far. Lastly, I'll leave you with this. Don't be disappointed in the results you didn't get by the work you didn't do to get you there. I've been a coach for a long time, been a teacher even longer. Work ethic, I will take that over somebody that has a ton of ability that just doesn't reach their potential all day. Keep working hard, guys. Done with chapter one. If you need any extra help with reviewing, please reach out to me, your TA, or any classmate or someone that you trust. Keep working hard, pushing through. We'll start on calculus on the next one. So long, everyone.